We'll call sock check, please. Good evening, everyone. Let's call to order our Lynnwood City Council work session for this evening, Monday, July 15th, 2019. And the first thing on our agenda is ACT, to save a life. It's training from our most favorite South County fire personnel. And Laurel Sprague has come forward, and so we are going to have, I think, about a half-hour presentation and then another half-hour of practice.
Actually, about 15 minutes of introduction. All right.
Well, we are so happy to have you here, ready to learn, and so I'm just going to let you take it away. Yeah, and if you're going to talk, are you going to... Right. So are you going to talk into the microphone at the podium? Yes, I think you should, because we're being recorded, so we'd appreciate that. So you can be at the podium, or you can sit here at this microphone, and council's used to turning around and looking at the front.
Okay.
How's that?
I'm going to introduce you to Chief Dahl, who is actually going to do the introduction part to our act.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and Council and friends. Really excited to be here to present a program that we are extremely proud of. And first, I'm Doug Dahl. I'm the interim fire chief. And for those of you that don't know, we are your fire department. We cover the cities of Montlake, Terrace, Edmonds, Briar, Lynnwood, and all unincorporated Snohomish County from about Everett down to this shoreline border. We have 14 stations, 260 operations members that are out in the street. We're about 30,000 calls, and out of those calls, 85% of those are EMS. So the emergency medical first aid part of our job is the main thing that we do. It's also the main thing we make the most difference on. A couple years back, our EMS chief, along with some of our EMS personnel, we all taught CPR and first aid. And as you know, most of you know, a CPR class is going to be about 3 hours long, and a first aid class takes about 8 hours in a day. And in today's world, people don't have time to give 8 hours. So we were getting 50, 60 people, maybe 100 people on a good year trained in first aid and CPR. And that's just not enough. So our crew put their heads together and said, how can we make a difference? And what they said is, what are the three things that we can change, that you, the citizens, can change before we get there? Instantly change and make a difference on. And they came up with something called ACT. You're going to learn a lot more about it. But it's the three main issues that we are seeing right now. It's opioid overdoses, it's cardiac-related issues, and it's trauma and bleed. So instead of an 8-hour class, put together that we can get out and teach you the very basics to save a life in about 45 minutes to an hour. So far this year, I believe we've hit full about 4,500 people. So far, 4,500 people trained. That is a tremendous difference. Easy for you to give up an hour, may not have a whole day, and this truly does save a life. So I hope it'll keep your attention because it's so quick. We've got some of the best instructors around. We're going to turn you over to them, but I really appreciate you guys reaching out and asking us to do this because you really can make a difference, and the chance of one of you putting this into play is pretty high right now. So, again, thank you, and we're here to answer any questions.
Thank you, Chief. So who's presenting next? Is that you, Larry?
Hi, everybody. Hi. How are you? I'm Larry. Good to be back. I see a lot of friendly, familiar faces. Oh, one not so friendly. No, just kidding. Anyway, it's good to be back. It's great to be back in Lynnwood. I'm stationed back over here again. It's nice to be in the area where I started. So we're South County Fire. I'm Larry, Chief Dahl, Chief Anderson, Vince, Laurel, Leslie, anybody else? We are South County Fire. We are your fire department, and we're here to talk about some pretty important issues tonight. I can tell you from family experience, the opioid epidemic is a scourge on our society. It's the only thing that makes me cry at night, and it's terrible. So we want to talk about it. I'm the data guy. I can tell you that not enough people in our community lay hands on chests when somebody's unconscious to save them from a cardiac arrest, and nobody knows what to do during an opioid overdose. About 70,000 people in 2018 overdosed on opioids. Many of those were accidental. They weren't the guy you see walking down the street with a backpack and a shopping cart who passes out in the bushes. Many of them were people just like you and I who have an opioid addiction issue, probably from dental surgery when they were a teenager, neck surgery, back surgery, hip replacement. Any of those things can cause an opioid addiction problem. About 40% of the people who get a 10-day run of pain pills from a doctor have a propensity to become addicted to opioids. Pretty powerful drug. We didn't know that. We didn't know that 10 years ago. We didn't know that 20 years ago. We used to go out and pronounce people dead. We had no idea that they were an opioid overdose. It's terrible. And it's in our community. It's in everybody's community. And we have to do something to address it. So how does it work? Opioids go to opioid receptors in your brain. It takes away the pain. It makes you forget about the pain. Unfortunately, too much of it also suppresses your respiratory drive. People don't die from taking the pill. They die from not breathing. They either stop breathing or they get in a position where they occlude their airway and they die. Who are we talking about? We're talking about your neighbor, my neighbor, your family member who maybe has severe back pain or had a hip surgery that didn't go well. Doctors give them a lot of pain meds. They hurt terribly. I know from experience taking OxyContin when I blew my neck up years ago. I was taking double the dose was normal. I could have just as easily woken up from one of my 45-minute naps. It was all I was allowed to sleep at a time. Taken another pill, gone to bed, and had somebody find me deceased. So what are we talking about here? Your neighbor, you know they had hip surgery. You know they're struggling with pain. You know that they're on pain pills. You go over and you check on them. You knock on the door, nobody answers. You walk in with your tray, because that's what we all do. We're all caretaker type people. We always bring food, we always bring a drink when we go visit somebody who's in need. And you notice that Sally, your neighbor, just doesn't seem right. She's laying in bed. She's kind of making snoring respirations. Something isn't right. You go and you shake her, and she's not waking up. Well, what are you going to do? First thing you're going to do is you're going to call 911. The most important thing you can do is call 911. If our crews are at the station watching the Super Bowl, eating popcorn, and making root beer floats, because the calls always come in during those times, if you don't call us, we're going to keep doing the same thing we do. You have to get us coming quickly. And we're going to teach you what to do in those first 5 minutes until we can arrive. Our response time in Lynnwood is better than 5 minutes. But it's kind of an average in our industry. It takes us about 5 minutes to get the call in, react, and arrive on scene. The next thing you're going to do is you're going to call for help. If you're at a window, if there's somebody in a house, or if you're in an apartment or a condo building, just go to the window and start screaming for help. Call for help. You need to get help, and you need to send somebody for help if you're alone. Send for help. Call 911, send for help, and then you have to act. What are you going to do to act? Well, you're going to listen to what the 911 dispatcher says, but you're also going to look around or ask somebody, say, hey, Sally's on pain meds. Does she have any of that Narcan stuff or naloxone, which is a narcotic antagonist that reverses the effect of opioids? It doesn't necessarily wake the person up, but it gets them breathing. They may wake up or they may not. But what we care about is that they're breathing. Because remember, we're 5 minutes away. We're just rolling out of the station now. And of course, there just happens to be a big fire that day. So it's going to be 7 minutes before somebody arrives. It always happens that way. You want to look around and see, does anybody have Narcan? If they say, yeah, I've got this thing here. My mom said, if I don't wake up, that I'm supposed to use it. And Vince over here can give you a demonstration behind you of what we're looking at. It might be a nasal device. It might be an electronic device. We'll demonstrate after I talk a little bit more, okay? Virtually every police car in America, I believe, has a nasal Narcan on them. We're going to start carrying that device in our vehicles because we give nasal Narcan too. Right now, we have to draw it up and with a syringe and put it up in nose. For less than we're paying for what we get now, we can get those nasal devices like the police carry for about half the cost because we're public safety and the manufacturer of that is almost giving it to us for cost. So look around. Ask if somebody has it. You may see somebody passed out on the street who has a drug addiction problem, and their girlfriend's running around circles screaming, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to do, and she's carrying the thing in her hand. We see that. We find Narcan on the trail next to our headquarters in South Everett. I personally found a fix kit and a Narcan kit sitting right next to each other where somebody had overdosed. Hey, at least they saved the life. We're not going to fix somebody in 15 minutes, but at least we give them a pathway and a new life to maybe navigate towards services that will change their life. Let's talk about Narcan. Narcan's available at almost every pharmacy on an open prescription. Soon, South County Fire is going to start leaving it behind if people request during an opioid overdose. You can go to the health department, you can get a prescription. You can talk to your doctor about it. If you have surgery or if your loved one has a need for pain medication, talk to your physician about getting Narcan. If you get a prescription, there's a good probability that the insurance will pay for it or at least partially cover the cost. It's not inexpensive to the consumer. So use every benefit you can to get it at the best cost. But we expect people to know about it, and we want you to pass the word that you can reverse opioid overdoses if you know what to do. You have to call 911. If you know CPR and you don't think their heart's beating, it's okay to give them CPR. Ask for Narcan and send somebody for help. But you have to act, because in the 5 minutes it takes us to get there, several million brain cells will have died, maybe 10 million brain cells. And even if the person survives, they'll probably not have a positive outcome and could have debilitating injuries from the anoxic injury of the brain by not breathing. And it happened, I can tell you, it happens almost every day in our area. Having looked at the numbers and done the reporting for the county prior to my retirement of my past position, we are seeing them dozens at a time in our area, and it's occurring all the time. Vince, you want to show the electronic one and we pass them out?
Say that my son is a physician at the Providence Hospital. He told me now that the standard practice for physicians at the hospital, if they prescribe a narcotic, they also prescribe Narcan. The advantage of that is then you only have to pay the doctor. You can go into a pharmacy and you can buy Narcan without prescription. So, you have this device here. This is the electronic.
It's so easy to use that my granddaughter, who's 5 but was 4 at the time, her mother's a drug addict. We have one at home and she carries one around with her sometimes. We taught her how to use it on Mr. Bear in case she ever finds her mom unconscious. So let's talk about, you have an event at the mall, you pull up and there's a car. Again, the girlfriend's running around screaming, doesn't know what to do. You see somebody passed out in the car or passed out on the ground next to it, and she's saying, he overdosed. The first rule of survival is save yourself. Never put yourself in a compromising position. If you don't feel safe and secure, step back, call 911, tell the dispatchers what's going on, but do not put yourself in a position where you could be harmed if you don't feel safe. That's our job. That's the police department's job. Our people get paid very well and have advanced training on how to deal with those situations. Additionally, if you do wake somebody up with Narcan, they will probably be pretty confused and they won't know where they are. So if you do deploy a Narcan device, whether an injectable device or in the nose, deploy it, follow the instructions, and back up about 10 feet, because it's not uncommon for some people to come up swinging or very confused. They may even want to get up and run away, and that's okay. Don't pursue them. Just get them breathing. Us and the police department, we will do the rest, because everybody is trained in this, and we know what to do. So your job is call 911, send for help, look for Narcan, and then act and deploy it.
This is my favorite part of class when everybody opens those up.
Well, they got the timing on good. They're in unison.
They push pretty hard.
He E, we have an executive session now, and we're asking for 10 minutes of exec session. So we will recess into the back room, and we will be back out in 10 minutes, unless we're not, and I'll let you know. So that completed our exec session with the topic of real estate. We're back at the table. Council President needed to go home because of an illness. So we'll move on to item C. This is our briefing number 2 for utility rate study 2020-2025. And it looks like Director Franz is going to kick us off.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. We were here with you on May 6th for our first briefing. This is our 3-year process we go through to set 6 years of rates. We do that with a series of briefings to bring you up to speed, get you comfortable with where we're at and where we're going. You'll notice who's not at the table tonight is our consultants, FCS. As we were working through some issues with them, we realized we had a couple of policy kind of things that we needed to talk to you about, and so we wanted to use tonight to do that. We didn't want to save them for later, save their fees and their budget for later when we need them more for the money stuff. So tonight it's staff, you know less, Rob Stello, Deputy Director, Jared Bond, Manager of Operations, and Derek Fada, who you have not met yet, I don't believe. He's our supervisor of our stormwater program and group. So the two topics we're going to cover tonight, the first one is our discount rates programs, and our second is related to stormwater. We're hoping to get some direction from you tonight, be able to circle back with FCS and the rest of staff, and continue on the rate setting schedule. We'd come back to you in probably most likely. We were looking at some August dates. I'm not sure we can make that happen, so probably early September. Maybe one other session with you after that, a public hearing, and then hopefully bring an ordinance to you in October or November-ish so that we can get the new rate schedules into place by January 1st. That is the goal, and we're very hopeful to stick to that schedule. Before I jump into the discount rates, I wanted to remind you of a couple of things. As we worked with FCS and we were chewing on those new wholesale water rates that Alderwood Water District, increases that Alderwood Water District put on all their customers, 10% in 2019 and 21% in 2020. I think last time we talked with you, I think I downplayed that a little. I didn't realize how big of a percent of our water expenditures was for wholesale purchase. I thought it was a smaller percent. It's 40% of our expenditures goes to buying water. And so 10 and 20% increases hurt. So that's one of the things we're dealing with and trying to figure out how to deal with without affecting overall rates too terribly. The other thing we're dealing with right now also is what we've talked to you before about in the budget process and at the last briefing. We had added 2 new staff in the budget in the utility. One was an infrastructure cartograph person. We have a ton of work now as we become more technically savvy to keep up the system of records, all electronic, of all of our infrastructure and the telemetry that monitors and runs our valves and water tanks and treatment plant and all of that. So there's a position for that. And then we also have a new position we'd like to fill for an additional wastewater treatment plant operator. We're just bare bones down there, and when anybody's sick or on vacation, it causes overtime. And we'll come back and bring you a calculation of the cost of being one person shy and overtime versus the cost of adding a person, and what we think will be, will show that it's undoubtedly a good idea to do that. But we committed to you at the time a budget that we wouldn't fill those positions until we do this analysis. And so that's, we're continuing to analyze that, and that's something we'll share with you when we come back next time. One of those two positions, the cartograph position, does play into some of the things that Derek and Jared are going to talk to later in the storm part. So just kind of keep that in the back of your minds that one of those FTEs kind of plays into some of the things you're going to hear there.
Yeah. Yes. Councilmember Hurst.
I just want to, for you to repeat again, the Alderley water increases are going to be 10%.
They were 10% in 2019,
yeah.
And next year 21%
more.
Yeah, on okay. top of the 10.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
What drove those less?
Treatment plant. The water treatment plant.
Treatment plant.
Their water, not their waste treatment plant. Their water quality. Their drinking water treatment. Okay. So, the first thing I wanted to do is. And I know you're always very interested in our low-income discount programs. And so often when we go through this process, we kind of leave that till later. And I thought, no, this is important. This is a good night to come and share with you where we're at, how it's doing, some of the impacts of the program, and then what we're going to recommend going forward. And so I thought the best way to do this was just to take a moment and step through each of we've broken them down into kind of their pieces, the programs. The first program is the old one. It's been here, I'm not sure when this one started. It's probably 20, 30 years ago. This is the discount program for anybody that owns real property and lives in real property, a house or a condo. And they qualify through Snohomish County for a real property tax exemption. So this was that old piggyback program where they bring in their tax exemption form. The county puts them as A, B, or C, which is a 50, 55, or 60%. We just take that, verify they live in Lynnwood, verify that they're the utility rate payer, and they get either 50, 55, or 60% off their bill. There's 249 of those. It seems like in the past there's always been maybe 200-ish, so this one's grown. The 183 of those received the largest discount, which is the 60% discount. When you do the math on that, that's about $600 a year. So it's real money. This one has no cap. You know, if we get more and more people that qualify for that, they bring their thing in, we don't have any kind of cap on that. The second one was one we added, my guess is maybe about 9 years ago. This one, we realized that there were folks that owned mobile homes or condominiums. Yeah, the first one actually didn't include condominiums, it just included single family homes. We realized, though, that people owned real property, but they didn't have a direct account with the city. They're you know, common meter, so they paid their utilities via their homeowner charges, right? So it's not as easy to figure out what to refund them. So we created this program, which was a rebate program. So they apply, they do the same thing, they bring their Snohomish County real estate exemption, and then show that they live in a Lynnwood condominium or mobile home park, and then we do a calculation where we take that complex, we see what they pay, we divide it by how many units there are, and out of that, we figure out what their share is, and then apply that 50, 55, or 60% discount to it. And so there's 102 of those participants in our program. The average here is a little lower, and that's because they're multifamily rates, and you know, so it's about 470 a year. And this one has no cap either. This one, I think, is slowly growing.
Councilmember Sutton.
Thank you, Mayor. Dr. Fries, does this include manufactured homes at all?
Because
it's different than a mobile home.
This really has to do with if you own a piece of property that you don't have, and you're tax exempt from the county, and you do not have a direct account with the city to pay utilities, i.e. you don't have your own meter. You pay through your homeowners. So if you had I suppose you could have a manufactured home that's in a trailer park and be in this program. But if you had a manufactured home on a regular lot that had a water meter, you wouldn't be in this program. You would be in the first program.
I see. Okay. That's my question. Thank you.
All right. The next program, and I believe this one we did 6 years ago, we realized that there were folks that may not qualify for the real estate exemption, but also have needs. And there's these two state programs, SNAP and TANF. One's food stamps, and one is just income. I think it's income support. This is geared toward people that own or reside in a residence that does make direct payment to the city, right? So what they need to do is they come in and they say, hey, I live in Lynnwood. I either own my house or I live in a rented house or something, and I pay utility bills directly. We give them a discount, that highest level discount. There's 68 of these folks. It's about $600 a year, and this one also has no cap. This was a good addition. What we realized, though, in doing that is we couldn't reach people that rented units, like rented apartments and so forth, and provide assistance. So this next program was 3 years ago, where we added a similar kind of program, but these folks just have to live in Lynnwood, whether they own their own house or whether they live in a complex, apartments or so forth. If they have a child in free and reduced meal program, they show that to us, and we give them a 50% discount, either actual based on if they're paying directly or if they're in a complex. We do that calculation again and find out what their share of the utilities are and give them that rebate. This one, if you remember this last time around, we set a cap of $100,000 on this program. I know that our staff has worked very hard with the school district and out there beating the bushes trying to get as many people as possible into the program. I think the first year it started lower. They're up to 47 participants. It averaged about $370 per year. You see, though, that we're not anywhere near our cap there. We're pretty low on the numbers, and I know they continue to work to try to get the word out to folks to take advantage of this. And then finally, a similar program we put into place 3 years ago, we realized also that there were seniors out there that don't own their own home and or don't qualify for the senior discount or any of those other discounts, but have a low enough income that we wanted to provide something for them. This is a similar program that they have to live in Lynnwood. They have to they come in and they share income tax return information to show that they meet this income standard, and then they get a similar rebate either based on their actual payments if they have a water meter or the calculation of their portion of their complex. There's about 76 of these. They average about $450 a year, and you'll see this one also is much below the $100,000 cap that was set by ordinance of $34,000. That one has room to grow.
I think you need to click twice.
I clicked twice. Oh, that's behind.
Yeah, there you go.
Thank you, Mayor. So this sheet just shows the total participants in each of those five. We're up to over almost 550 folks that we're helping right now. One thing that we did as FCS came in and we were working on the numbers overall for the rates, Sergey said, for the first time, they're seeing a bit of an impact from these programs in our rates. We were for a moment he was saying, I was wondering why the expenditures weren't just quite as high as what we thought they should be, and looking into it, it's because these programs have taken off. So we are at the point of seeing that impact. It's not a great impact, but it's something that can be seen now. It relates to about 2% roughly. We're very pleased with the numbers. I think these programs have blossomed and will continue to do so as needs arise and as our staff gets out there and communicates, gets the word out. I understand last week you went over to the senior center and took one of the utility billing folks to tell the seniors over there about the programs.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
A couple of takeaways before I answer questions. Roughly about 4% of our single-family and multifamily residents are assisted by these programs. I was actually surprised it was that high, but it's about 4%. We believe that the yearly amounts we're offering folks through these programs are decent amounts of money, you know, up to $600 a year. The old programs aren't capped, so those can continue to grow. These new programs have a lot of room to expand. I think we've found really good ways to hit lots of different segments, from seniors to folks with kids that are struggling to, you know, different segments who own and or rent. Our recommendation at this time is to stay the course and continue doing what we're doing. I know in the past, every time for a decade or more, we've looked at ways to expand. Unless we hear otherwise, I think what we'd like to do is stay the course, continue to work hard and especially in these new programs, to get the word out, to see if we can come up closer to those caps. I think there's probably at least several years to grow before we hit those caps, unless the economy does something bad. So that's kind of what we're looking for you tonight on this issue, is questions, of course, and to know we're okay going ahead with.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. First of all, thank you for putting the presentation in the council packet. So, gold star.
You're welcome.
Appreciate that. I think for me, I think it would be good to ask FCS for a recommendation on caps for all the programs, just to looking at, as part of their analysis, like for the financial structure of the utility mm-hmm. as a enterprise fund, I think it'd be good to just understand what those programs could grow to before we would want to go, okay, this is a decision point, because you're right. I mean, at some point, if the economy does change, we're likely to see an increase in usage of these programs, which would be great, but it would also mean that would erode some of the revenue for that enterprise fund. So I think it would be important to understand what the enterprise fund could take from a cap standpoint, and just get a recommendation. I'm very happy to see that they're getting used, and thanks to your staff for getting the word out. And I'm glad to see that these are doing some good for the people that need it. I also want to be mindful of the integrity of the overall system financially. So,
and remember how those caps work. It's not like we hit our cap and then the next person that comes in, we say sorry. We collect right. them all and we divide, so they're 600. They might yes. all go to 575.
Right.
It just diminishes across the board, everybody's amount.
Right.
When we get to the cap.
Yep. And I think so. There were three programs that had no cap, and so
right.
we'd want to look at a recommendation for what those should maybe cap out at. But thank you for the reminder. Yeah.
Councilmember Sessions.
Thank you. Also, good news to see people are using this. I'd like to continue to find creative ways to get the word out. Can you tell us, just for a person who's hearing this or somebody we're talking to, what do they need to do to find out if they qualify at all? I mean, maybe they don't, but who exactly in which building do they need to go and talk to?
Right. Front desk, right here.
Front desk.
Deb Cornelius, or
okay.
Yeah.
And they bring in
Sharon. Sharon Crandall.
Crandall, right?
Or Deb, both could help.
Okay, very good. And the front desk here at the City Hall. And what do they need to bring in to prove whatever they need to prove?
Well, probably the first trip might just be a come in and talk about it, and they could assist them to get a feel for maybe which program, and then they could send them on a little homework run to bring back something, whether, you know.
There's a form, and one of them goes to the county.
Okay.
And we do have, I know they created materials, too, that they hand out.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Councilmember Ross?
I'm just curious, would it be easier just to have one program that would incorporate all of this?
No, I think the way it's structured, because they're all different and they all target different things and have different criteria, I think this worked pretty well. I know you remember in the past I was always fearful of mm-hmm. The workload, and you know, and I think we've worked into something with Sharon's help and expertise that she brought from Mount Lake Terrace, where she did similar things. It's worked out pretty well, and I think my fears weren't founded.
Great.
Vice President Frizzell.
I really appreciated Councilmember Cotton's idea of having a cap, but I'd like to see that as a percentage of total revenue rather than a strict dollar amount. Thank you.
Other questions?
Okay, then let's pivot.
Thank you.
To the second
can
part.
We scoot and, these
and thank two you very much for your questions and.
You too, guys. Share. Les, that's yours.
And advice. So, Derek.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, Derek?
About myself. My name is Derek Feda. I've been working for Lynnwood for about 4 years now. I started working under Jared when he was in my current position as the education outreach coordinator for Stormwater. So 6 months ago I was promoted and I'm taking on Jared's old duties and I'm going for it. So thanks for having me. Yeah. So, tree voucher guy? Yeah, we do that. So I was the old tree guy, so now we have a new Cameron is his name. Yeah. So I'm here today to talk about our stormwater program and potential staffing needs from upcoming permit requirements for the new permit that's about to come out in August. So we'll go over that. So first I'll talk a little bit about our stormwater program, what we do. The main responsibilities for our program are maintaining and upgrading stormwater infrastructure. And while doing that, keeping the ideas of reducing flooding and improving our water quality in mind. And then also, one of the things that my group deals with, the Environmental Surface Water Group, is complying with federal and state regulations. The Clean Water Act was implemented in 1972, and pretty much what it did is made any discharge to surface waters with pollutants illegal. And so the NPDES program came from that. It was implemented because it realized that jurisdictions and entities such as municipalities couldn't feasibly discharge the surface waters without polluting them. For example, just roadways, you got the oil running off from cars and sediment that gets on the roads. So that program was implemented, and the main majority of what our group does is complying with those permit regulations. So it says if you follow the permit for the national or the NPDES permit, you can discharge those pollutants into the surface waters, and to a certain extent, obviously. So going over our staff and what we do, we have the Environmental Surface Water Group, which is myself. We have an inspector and education outreach coordinator who deal primarily with the NPDES permit and meeting those requirements. But we do have other programs in our group that we run. And then on the other side of things, you have the operations and maintenance group who we get a lot of contributions from upper management and supervisors and foremen that make up those employees, as well as six dedicated maintenance workers to the storm department. So
let me just say very briefly, because you're doing the math and you're thinking, how do you get to 11.45 FTEs? There's six maintenance workers that are fully paid by the storm utility. There's the three people in Derek's group, makes nine. And then you also, the way we budget now, we allocate, so a piece of myself, a piece of Les, a piece of Jared, a piece of the supervisor, a piece of the foreman, or shared with different groups. That's how we get to 11.45.
So now I'm going to dive a little deeper in the NPDES permit and exactly what the requirements are and what we're doing to meet them or what we're going to have to be doing to meet the new permit. On August 1st, 2019, the new permit will be go into effect and it will last until July 31st, 2024. The previous permit ran from 2013 to 2018 and it was extended a year and is current still and will expire on July 31st. Pretty much this NPDES permit has several core requirements which encompass stormwater planning, educating the public about pollution potentials to our surface water, and doing outreach to involve the public in kind of attacking this regional problem that we have here. We're required to map our storm system, create a program that identifies illicit discharges or pollutant being discharged into our system and figuring out ways to remedy those. We're required to control runoff and pollutants being discharged off of construction sites, and then we're also operating and maintaining our own system. And at the bottom here, you'll see the source control programs for existing development. This is a new core requirement that the Department of Ecology, who runs the NPDES permit, is implementing this year. So I'll get into that a little bit later and explain what this requirement is going to be. So over here on the right side of this slide, we have the requirements for permit compliance. Right now, we have a consultant, Herrera, who's doing our surface water comprehensive plan update. And they took a look at our NPDES program here that we run at the city and identified gaps in the program and what we'll need to do to meet the requirements of the current permit right now and the new permit coming out next month. So I'll go over the current permit and the requirements that we are a little deficient in, that we need more resources and time to be able to meet those requirements. The first one is mapping and documentation of the stormwater system. We have a map right now, but it's going to take some updating and some tweaking, you know, to make us happy with it. So we feel we're in compliance with it, but there's still some improvement there. We need to come up with a training program for field staff so they can identify like potential discharges or pollutant discharges to our storm system and know who to call after that, and then so we can come out and help them. That needs to be for field staff, such as the maintenance crews, the police department or fire department, anyone who's out in the field who could potentially see something like this. Other things we need to do is develop a plan review process and checklist along with the mapping and documentation. It goes along the same lines as we have that in place, but it's something we need to improve on to be able to be in compliance with the permit. One of the big on-takings from the previous permit is we were required to inspect all private facilities such as like detention ponds, stormwater vaults, and other control structures. And so we have staff who took that on, but we weren't able to be in compliance with that because of turnover issues, and on the public side, we had a migration issue with our asset management system. So I'll move on to the new requirements coming up in the permit that starts on August 1st. The source control program is the one that I identified as being a new core requirement. Pretty much what the source control program is going to be is this, we're going to have staff go out to businesses and inspect those businesses for potential pollution generating activities to our surface water. So we're looking for the, like a leaky garbage bin left out in the open that could be getting into our system, or maybe a business is washing cars out in their parking lot. And so we'll have to have an inspector going out and taking a look at those sites. And then there'll be some upfront workbook. We'll have to create a business inventory of all these potential inspection sites and then prioritize certain areas based off of water quality and then implement the program. So this will be phased in over time. This isn't an instant requirement that we have to be in compliance within 2019. Other things that we're going to have to add to our program is under the comprehensive stormwater planning, we're going to have to start reviewing our low impact development policies annually and make sure that our policies in place don't restrict the addition of low impact development. And a big one is creating an action plan for our stormwater planning or in our region. So we have to identify all the basins in Lynnwood or this region and look at each basin individually and monitor and determine which basin would be most help from adding stormwater facilities that can reduce water quantity and quality. And so that's going to cost some extra staff time and some money to do that research plan. And then, as always, we have our education programs and outreach. And this year, they're kind of having us add another program or adopt a new one where it needs to be trackable, so we need to be able to document training sessions and such, and how we did our outreach activities. And then from that, we need to have a assessment done or evaluation of the program that determines if there is behavioral change coming from this program and how effective it is. So as I mentioned earlier, the NPDES permit came from the Clean Water Act, and the EPA delegated authority to the state of Washington to issue the permits and enforce them as well. So the Department of Ecology is who issues our permits, and they also enforce. So if we don't comply with the permit, they're the ones who are going to be the ones who find out. So the way they determine, or the way they enforce our permit, is through a management plan that we have to do annually. We have to talk about how we're going to meet the permit requirements before the year and come up with a plan to meet those requirements. At the end of the year, we're required to fill out an annual report that talks about how we met those requirements, so it's a before and after kind of thing. Department of Ecology has been known to do some surprise inspections on our construction sites to see if our policies are being implemented onto the site, if they're discharging any pollutants, and then they also visit city facilities like the operations and maintenance center to make sure that we're compliant with our regulations there as well. Though every couple years, I believe, they audit a couple cities. It's all randomly selected, and that's how they determine if those cities are following their plans and if the regulations haven't been followed. There can be fines, warnings, all that to ensue. And so one major thing that the Department of Ecology does have you do is if you are aware you're out of compliance with your permit, you need to notify them. So in that notice, you need to outline why you're not compliant, how you will get back into compliance, and then when you will be back in compliance. So for the future outlook, Jared, did you want to talk a little bit about the comprehensive plan?
Yeah, right now, it was mentioned earlier that we have Herrera on staff working on our update to our comprehensive plan. I believe they're pretty far along. So before the end of the year, probably in the next, I would say, September, October, we'll be coming back to you to kind of unwrap some of these things that we're discussing in further detail, but also go through the public process for adopting this comprehensive plan. There's a lot of there's a gap analysis, you know, that's leading to some of these recommendations that are here. As you can see, additional staff will be needed in order to comply with some of these requirements. The in-depth look on that will be in the comprehensive plan as well. So we'll be talking more about this stuff here in the next couple months.
What we hope to achieve with you tonight was to remind you of the stormwater program, the NPDES permit, those permit requirements. This is, you know, the NPDES permit for stormwater, has they've been trying to figure that out for a couple decades. Because it's non-point, you know, we have an NPDES permit at our treatment plant, and that's pretty simple. We have a pipe that goes out to the water. You can test it, and you know if you're in compliance or not, and many other very definable kinds of things. So we're used to a very strict permit down there. If we get out of whack, we test, we're making many tests every day. We have to submit those. If we're out of whack, they're all over us instantly. So we know and respect the DOE and our NPDES permit. Stormwater lagged behind that because of this non-point issue. You know, we're the city of Lynnwood. We have control of our streets and our streams and so forth. If a person on private property dumps oil, it ends up in our stream. And then we become responsible for it. So it's very difficult to prevent that from happening. So they come up with these general programs of how to deal with stormwater, and they're multifaceted. And I think Derek did a great job of walking you through many of those and trying to minimize that as much as possible. These programs have matured to the point now that they are now kind of in that same league as the NPDES for our treatment plant. They're dead serious. They're coming every year. They're ensuring that we develop these plans and programs. Like Derek said, we have to do these things. We have to commit to doing them. We have to be on a timeline. And now as we've looked at them and hired our consultants to outline these things, understanding what we're not even currently doing with our current permit, knowing there's a gap there, plus what's coming, The analysis shows that we really need a couple full-time additional people to do that. The thing is, we don't need them this year. We don't need them necessarily next year. The permit is phased in over the five-year period. This rate study is a six-year period, right? So what we kind of wanted to explain that to you, and then when we come back at our next briefing on the rate study, and as we kind of come up with a phase-in plan of these folks, we will be able to share that with you then of what year we bring out and what person, what those costs are, and how that affects the rates. The thing that the bad news is we can't avoid this, and you know, we talked a lot about, is there ways to achieve this without adding additional staff? And, you know, on learning that we're currently not even meeting, we're struggling to meet current permit requirements. These next permits take us to another level. I'm convinced and am recommending that we do look at two FTEs and phasing them in over this five-year period. I wanted to get you used to that idea and understanding that that will have an impact. And we're committing to doing that in as prudent of way as possible. You know, we'll put things off as long as we possibly can, as long as we can meet our permit requirements. And we're not suggesting in any way that we're going beyond our permit requirements, or above and beyond, but we want to meet those minimum requirements safely enough that we're not always concerned about fines and being found out of compliance. But
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. First of all, Derek, good job.
Oh, thank
yeah.
you.
No, it's like presenting, right? It's like public speaking. It's
yeah.
fun. So great work. And I appreciate the presentation and the reminder and kind of the update on how these permits are being handled from a stormwater standpoint. Just in kind of as we're talking about the whole system, the utility, I hope that this comment's kind of germane to the overall conversation, and that as we're watching the rates that were being charged to purchase, just that, I think the last time you came with that percentage, I kind of mentioned that it might be good to just, as we're continually do the rate study, that we're just keeping the back of our mind at some point, it may not exist, but is there a tipping point where it makes sense to treat our own stormwater and effluent to the point of being potable water again for some kind of use? Because my thought is at some point, you know, water may, you know, they say in the Inland Empire, whiskey's for drinking, water's for fighting. So we might not be seeing that, hopefully, in our lifetime, but it might not be a bad idea just to keep our eye on it. So otherwise, great. Thank you for the update.
Councilmember Hurst.
A few questions. One, so the last slide had some culverts and stuff. Do we have to worry about culverts here as far as, you know, the
fish,
salmon?
Fish passage.
Yeah, fish passage.
That's a different issue. That's not being regulated under this permit.
Okay.
This is like, so there's a different permit that's triggered when we're doing construction projects. So if we touch any of this surface water, you know, any of the creeks in town or anything like that, then yeah, they are almost certainly, the new regulatory environment going to say, oh, that culvert has to be fish passable. And there's certain design requirements for that, and of course, a lot of expense.
Yeah.
But that's not being driven by this current permit.
By that, okay. And then, I heard mentioned, so washing cars in a lot, in a parking lot, or how about all these car dealers? Do they have certain car wash areas then now that are compliant? And
yeah.
If we see any teenage boys out there washing cars in a lot, we
yeah, a lot of the lots we end up doing for our private facility inspections have their own private wash bays
yeah.
that are tied into the sewer system. We do get a lot of calls through our pollution hotline of people, or not people, but businesses washing cars out in their parking lot. So residents are aware of this problem and they do report it to us.
Okay, cool. And then last, just something I read or somebody was talking to me about stormwater drains that ca- capture oil. Is there such a thing? I mean, is that?
There's a couple different products out there that do that. There's canister filters, effectively, that are, like in a parking lot, all the drains in the parking lot would be piped to this one structure that would have multiple different canisters in them, and it does remove the oil. There's also oil-water separator technology. It's antiquated, and if you don't maintain it frequently, the oil eventually will just blow right through and come right in. So we're moving more towards these canisters, these filters, effectively, that do better. They're easier to check when they need maintenance.
So we do have...
It's a better product.
We do have...
City has several facilities like that, as well as pretty much any new parking lot, new construction that's out there will have that technology too.
Oh, good. Good enough. Thank you.
Other questions, Council? All right. Well, thank you very much, gentlemen. Good work.
Thank you.
You survived, Derek.
Fist bump.
Council, do you need a five-minute break?
Yes.
Come back at 9 as we regroup. Council, well, welcome back. Let's move on with our agenda tonight, moving into item E. This is a briefing for the proposed draft development agreement for North Line Village. Director David Kleitch is here to give an introduction, and then you can introduce your staff.
You have received a briefing on this project on June 17th. This is the second briefing. I'd like to introduce Carl Ogram, who is the City Center Program Manager. And Carl will walk you through the document. Our goal is to continue to walk through documents for you so you can get comfortable with it. I will say that this isn't a final draft. This is a draft document, as we explained in the council memo. But clearly, at final, you'll get a full track changes version and you'll know where we are. So with that, I would turn it over to Carl so he could go through the item for you, and then you'll have an opportunity to ask questions.
Thank you, Director Kleitch. We're going to recap the first pre-hearing and kind of get you reoriented to the site. We're also going to revisit the site plan itself, as well as we've have a stitched together orientation with Sound Transit, so you'll be able to see how those two projects pair together. We're going to showcase some of the concept images that are highlighted in the concept plan to kind of give you a better idea of the visuals that the development team, Merle and Geyer, is proposing for this site. And then we're going to do a walkthrough of the development agreement and the exhibits to kind of provide nearly a page-by-page orientation of the proposal. And then at the end of the presentation, we'll talk about next steps and have an opportunity to take questions. To recap, this is a quasi-judicial process. We do encourage the council to ask questions. We will take any questions we don't know. We will document them and provide you answers at the time of the public hearing. But we do stress to make sure that you maintain an unbiased comment period during this time. The proposal is 19.1 acres. It is going to be located between 196th and Alderwood Mall Boulevard along 44th Avenue. It does include a proposal of slightly over 500,000 square feet of office, with a proposal of 60,000 square feet of professional office, of which would be similar to dentist offices, things like that. There's a component with this of slightly over 250,000 square feet of retail, and a proposal to potentially include a movie theater as 50,000 square feet of entertainment. One of the other major components with this proposal is approximately 1,369 dwelling units. This is to recap where we left off from the pre-hearing motion. If you read through some of the development agreement, you would have seen these numbers are a little bit more generalized in the actual agreement. So this is the site plan that we left off with at the last meeting. Again, lots A, B, and C, primarily being a residential building with retail components along 45th Avenue, three different public spaces, with a Village Green Park, a Festival Street, and the Pocket Oasis 46th Ave Park. And then three different lots. Lot H would be a office tower, Lot G would be an office tower, and Lot J in between them would be a parking garage. Lot D is proposed to potentially have a grocer as well as with a residential component. And then Lot E would include a a gym and a drugstore, and then Lot F would include the movie theater. Between these two sites would also include a parking garage. So just to kind of help you get reoriented with this. 196 is located to the right of your screen with 44th Avenue along the bottom of your screen. So when we look at this tied with Sound Transit, we can truly see how much development is going to be occurring within the city center over the next period. To help you orient, this is 200th right here, 44th along the bottom of your screen, and 196 to the right of your screen. So we can see those park spaces, the Village Green, the Festival Street, the 46th Pocket Park, and then 46th Avenue West, which will match up to 46th Avenue with the Lynnwood Station. This intersection will provide opportunity for vehicles to come in and go through a kiss and ride to do a pickup drop-off and return to this intersection here. What this intersection doesn't truly support is it doesn't support demand of the parking garage. So if somebody's coming to visit Sound Transit, this was one of the questions that council had had at the previous pre-hearing, people would enter the parking garage from 44th Avenue, take this parking garage access into the parking garage. They would have the opportunity to return back to 44th Avenue and then head southward along there. Or they would actually come out along this way all the way to 48th Avenue. So there was a concern with having potential cut-through traffic up 46th. We don't believe that's going to be as significant of an issue in the long run. This is just to help you kind of visualize what this would overall see. I probably should point out the tracks themselves. The tracks are going to be coming in through here with the station in this vicinity and then continuing across 44th for the terminus until ST3 takes it up. This section right here is the promenade that's going to terminus at 44th and 200th. I think that highlights kind of how these two functions work together. When we look at some of the concept images with the proposal for Northline Village, you can start to see some of the densities and some of the changes from the single-story retail buildings that we have to having some density and having this activation within some of the streetscapes. Situations with dining areas approaching the street and having this interaction there, as well as the proposal of a rendering with this interaction of interacting with the public space there. And then here are two additional images, one being that of connection with Sound Transit, as well as a mixed-use building with a commercial retail function on the base floor with multifamily above. We've provided a significant number of documents for you within the development agreement, including not only the development agreement, but a significant number of exhibits. We're going to walk through a significant number of those, but we are providing you a summary of these items tonight. So laying the groundwork within the first few sections of the development agreement include the recitals, which identify how a city is allowed to adopt a development agreement, how does this function within the EIS and the Plan Action Ordinance, and then does this actually promote the comprehensive plan and signifying that yes, this type of project is proposed to support the comprehensive plan. And then within the first two sections includes a definition section to make sure that we're speaking the same terms. Project two is when we start to see some of the generalization of the proposal to provide that flexibility in the future. As you can see, these numbers are rounded. In section 2.2 identifies different levels of flexibility, and the current proposal right now identifies a opportunity for the owner to have a certain amount of flexibility, and then the opportunity for the owner to request flexibility that would be reviewed administratively, and then it identifies when does the flexibility require council approval again. And so we're still working through different elements within this development agreement with the applicant. And so you may see some of these changes coming across. During the last pre-hearing, there was a question about how is this project going to get phased. And it's a very great question, and it's a very difficult question to answer because of the market factors associated with the redevelopment of the site. What the proposal has included is Exhibit D, which is a block plan for different improvements, which essentially would be a puzzle piece function within how does this project go together. So in this color coordination, I do apologize with this map. We've been looking at orientation with 196 to the right of your screen. 196 is now at the top of your screen. So what this map shows is that if Lot A was to develop, Lot A would develop this section of 46th as well as this section of 45th. And then when Lot B would develop, it would then develop 198th and the Pocket Oasis Park. And then when Lot C would develop, it would develop the Village Green Park and then the remainder of 46th. So it's pieced together to ensure that there is adequate infrastructure for the sites, as well as there's a proposal to make sure that requirements for EMS servicing or EMS services would be provided, and that's located later in the DA. So this kind of helps showcase not necessarily when things are going to happen or what phase is going to be first, but it identifies what pieces are going to go together with each block. One of the other things we'd like to clarify within the project is the different pieces of land associated with this site. So in this blue outline, you can see here, it goes around two different parcels. That blue outline represents the current configuration of the parcels. It does not include what is currently the key bank, as well as the precision tune. The proposal for this project would be to purchase the rights for the precision tune, as well as the key bank in the future. It does also have an additional element with this, where if the Shell station ever becomes available, that would be an additional parcel that could be then added to this plan. It does focus on what is called allowable development capacity, focusing on that a certain level of threshold would provide that level of flexibility and kind of a cap for how much change could occur on the site. Looking at Section 3 vesting, certain things would be quote-unquote grandfathered where possible, things that would not be included. Stormwater does not vest, the building and fire codes would not vest, and then the development fees would not vest. Part of the vesting section is that an annual report would be provided to the city by the owner, and that the city would have the opportunity to review that annual report. Section 4 under project review, this helps identify some of the nuances within the proposal. One being 44th Avenue West, which is proposing to have parking garages along 44th Avenue West, as well as a proposed kiosks to be located in the Village Green. So this is one of the items that we're still collaborating and working together with the Merlone-Geyer team to address is mitigation factors associated with the 44th Avenue West facade. So again, now we are back to 196 being to the right of your screen, with 200th being to the bottom. Sorry, thank you. 44th along the bottom with 196 to the right of your screen. What this image is showing what this would be what this would look like relatively as a massing model associated with facing a parking garage along 44th. And so we're working through different ways of mitigating that, and the proposal does have other ways, including landscaping, architectural features, and we're working to redefine and really clarify what those elements would be. But from this facade, what you can see is this tower here of the office building would be associated with this block here, and this tower here would be associated with Lot G. These colors are associated with different land uses, and the gray would be the parking garages. And one thing to note is this area along here would not be at the 44th facade frontage. It would be set back behind what is currently the Shell gas station. So this is an item that we're still working through with the applicant, and we feel we're having great collaboration. SEPA compliance. The city adopted an EIS, an environmental impact statement, and adopted the planned action ordinance, and that this project would comply with both of those functions. And as such, there would be no additional SEPA mitigation required for the project within the allowable development capacity. So if the project came back and was above the allowable development capacity, it would be reviewed against the planned action ordinance and reviewed against the EIS, and potentially in the future could require SEPA mitigation, but as currently proposed, would not. Traffic concurrency. The city of Lynnwood has a requirement to comply with the Growth Management Act as associated with concurrency, and that's to make sure that our facilities have adequate transportation services before development permits are being issued. The proposal is going to generate an estimated 1,080 new PM peak trips. That would be net new trips. So that'd be taking into account their current uses and then their new demand and then deducting the difference. That difference would be 1,080. Transportation improvements. They're proposing internal private streets. So again, we've changed orientations on the map. 196 is now at the top of your screen with 44 on the right of your screen and 200 on the bottom of your screen. They are proposing that the internal streets of the project be private and be privately maintained with different elements associated with that, including a need for a signal at 198th and 44th. The current proposal is for a shared cost with the city on that signal and then working together on a 44th widening of potential mitigation there. Excuse me, let me backtrack. The signal is being proposed to be this would be cost shared equally, and then the construction of the signal would be timed with either the 44th widening, which is a project the city of Lynnwood has proposed, or with the development of lot F or lot G. So this would be lot F or lot G. There's no anticipated need for signal at the 196 and 46th. At this intersection here, it's proposed to be a right in and a right out. And the signal at 200th and 46th is going to be improved by Sound Transit, and the proposal includes that the city would advocate for the alignment to occur with a future extension. There is a element of flexibility. Our current standards do not call for a shared use path along 44th, and as we're having preliminary discussions on our active transportation plan, there is considerations of potentially that needs to be a shared use path. So we're collaborating with Marlon Geyer to potentially allow that shared use path to happen, and that's still being further refined for a future clarification of the development agreement. 196, as you know, is being completed by the city of Lynnwood, and the improvements along 200th and 46th are proposed to exceed the city center standards. The transportation impact fees are proposed to essentially follow the currently adopted LMC, as well as proposed to utilize the city center trip exemption that's already in the code. Shifting gears away from the transportation is into the parks and public space. The proposal is to utilize a supplemental site design guidelines to essentially identify that the park spaces aren't currently designed, but we know that there's going to be certain elements that they'd like to see. And so as an exhibit to the development agreement, the supplemental site design guidelines would further define what would be a minimum within those designs. The construction of the parks are going to be based on the phase improvement plan, that block-by-block development that I had pointed out. And the proposal also includes that they would review the design of the parks with the Parks and Recreation Board for recommendation. These park spaces, important to point out, would be owned and operated by Marlon Geyer. They would be private property, they would be privately maintained, but they would allow for public access. To highlight some of the points in the exhibit for the supplemental site design guidelines, for the Village Green, there'd be a minimum size of 29,400 square feet, a minimum hardscape coverage of 4,000 square feet. Hardscape would be concrete area, stamped concrete, pavers, those type of things, and then a minimum lawn area of 10,000 square feet with a splash pad or water play area of 300 square feet minimum. It does have a pick option, so they'd be allowed to pick a water feature or a public art installation or a public pavilion as a element to be incorporated. The supplemental site design guidelines also clarify the Pocket Oasis Park to have a minimum size of 21,000 square feet, and incorporate a dog park of 2,500 square feet with some sort of play structure, and that's the proposal right now. A little bit different than the Village Green, it does have a list of at least two options, one being pedestrian paths, another being dog obstacle course, colored concrete option, which would be tied into the Festival Street where it would be brought in across, an additional dog play area potentially as an option. And then it does have the opportunity for adding at least one of either a water feature or an art installation. The Festival Street is fairly tightly designed in the sense that it does have several must-haves, including a flush curbed or raised style street with activated ground floor uses, pavement such as a brick or stamped concrete, and then 10-foot walkways. Section 10 is the park impact fees. It does follow roughly the adopted code regarding those impact fees, and the construction of the parks is to occur with the phase improvement plan, some of that block development. One difference in the park impact fees is it does include a proposal for provision that would allow the developer to post a surety to the city to gain credit for the impact fee for the park improvements that they're going to do. That way, when they do the park improvements, they don't necessarily lose them out depending on timing. It's to balance a opportunity for a credit in the future. Sections 11 and 12. Section 11 includes other impact fees. So currently in the city of Lynnwood, we have traffic and park impact fees. The state allows us to state allows the opportunities for school impact fees as well as fire impact fees. This would vest the project to the current impact fees, and then if the city was going to adopt fire or school impact fees, then those would be tied into where the projects are regarding project entitlement, such as how far are they along within the phases. Section 12 includes incorporation of the multifamily tax exemption. It does regard that the city would review and approve the applications pursuant to the adopted code. However, it does have provisions that the owner does not have to participate in it. Regarding utilities, Section 13 includes stormwater detention and treatment. As we previously mentioned, stormwater does not vest, so as each phase come in, they would be required to follow the Department of Ecology requirements. The proposal identifies an acknowledgement that there is sufficient stormwater capacity. On the site, there is currently a city easement for a portion of a pipe. The development agreement would actually relinquish the city from that easement and that maintenance responsibility. Section 14 identifies two projects to upgrade water and sewer to service their site with an acknowledgement of capacity. And then Section 15 identifies utility charges that the owner would pay connection charges. However, the city would commit to not levying additional costs for off-site utility infrastructure. The last section I wanted to highlight for you tonight in this abbreviated summary includes a proposal for their current term. The term is how long the development agreement would last. The proposal right now is for a initial term of 15 years, and then if a certain amount of project occurs, that there would be a 10-year addition added on to making a total of 25 years. And that would allow, if the project doesn't move forward, within the first 15 years, the development agreement would expire. But if certain elements here, such as construction of one or more project phases, building applications for two or more project phases, if things like that occur, there would be an extension of 10 years for that. One caveat to the proposal right now is what's called an economic force majeure, such as it's to be defined with a delay in the arrival of Sound Transit, or if Snohomish County has a negative GDP for more than two quarters, that recognizes that those economic constraints could delay the opportunity to implement the development agreement. So the proposal right now is to have essentially a stacked function with a pause button in case of recession. I've gone over a lot of information tonight, and I appreciate sitting through the sections after Section 18. We rely on our city attorney to review. The meat of our concerns are primarily sections 1 through 18, which we've discussed tonight. Looking at next steps, there's an opportunity to ask staff questions regarding this item. And then there's a tentative plan to move this to a work session on August 5th with potentially a public hearing on August 12th. That would be the earliest that we would be able to move this application forward. However, as Director Kleitsch has pointed out, that this is still a collaborating effort, and we're still working on finalizing details. So there may be the need to amend these dates as needed.
Yep, Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Honor, and thank you, Carl and Director Kleitsch. Great presentation. It's a lot of information. I appreciate you kind of walking us through this, not just for us, but also for all those tuning in to Radio Lynnwood. This is a very exciting development opportunity for the city, and it's a really, I mean, it's a big piece in our downtown. So, just a couple questions, and I apologize if some of it stated clearly throughout the document, but I didn't see it, so I'll just ask. As part of the July 9th memo, when you're talking about the section to the project, the following would be permitted by right to development on the property. The square footages of the different uses, the professional office, the office building, the entertainment, the all that, does that set the max cap amount that they would be able to develop, meaning they would be able to develop less than if market conditions, or does it establish like a band that they have to be within plus or minus? How does that work within the agreement?
That's an excellent question. So these levels are for a maximum threshold percentage. Okay. And so there would be the opportunity that they could develop less than these proposals. However, the infrastructure that they've identified is based on this extent of potential future development. There is also an additional element within the flexibility in Section 2 that would provide a reallocation, essentially, of the mm-hmm. intensities, such as when light rail opens, there may be efficiencies gained within the infrastructure to allow an additional up to 10% to be reviewed. And as it's currently proposed, is to be reviewed administratively. So these numbers do have some fluctuations, and then within Section 2.2, there's additional flexibility that would allow a transferring of some intensities between residential to office, or office, or essentially non-residential uses to mm-hmm. residential uses.
So there's flexibility to allow them to make it pencil out as a development, but is there anything that's in our code that then would establish the minimum level of development being at city center? Is that part of our city center standards, or?
We do have a minimum height development, being that of the three stories, and the proposal has not requested a deviation to that minimum height.
Okay.
So the expectation would be that they're proposing to identify and build to these limits.
Okay, thank you. And then the second question would be on, I think it was Section 7, you were talking about something along 44th. Yes, the shared cost, where is it? Yes, the shared cost.
So I do apologize.
Shared used path option.
So yeah. I tried so that? Hard to make sure that I got the council the packet. I did have two bullets in here that was a copy and paste error. So please ignore these two bullets are in italics.
Okay.
However, the frontage along 44th Avenue incorporates what type of pedestrian facilities may be located there.
Okay.
A shared use path is typically a 10 to 12 foot wide asphalt or concrete hard surface facility that you could have mixed use on it, including bicycles, pedestrians, joggers, individuals with strollers, those type of things.
Okay, so it doesn't have to do with like utility easements or anything like that?
Not in this case. And the reason for the alternative for the shared use path and this potential future option is that as we're starting the active transportation plan, it's about how do we make sure that we can provide different facilities within the city that would be appropriate for walking, biking, running, individuals with strollers, individuals with wheelchairs, and we requested an opportunity to potentially vary from our standard in this condition.
Okay. And
I apologize. One last question. In the concessions and commitments section, item two, there was a piece about the 2.2-acre park, and then I noticed in the document submitted that there's roughly about 1.68 acres worth of parks that are being provided as part of the Village Green and the Festival Street and the Pocket Park. I just want to make sure we're tracking with that, and I'm sure you guys are. That's all part of what you're doing. I just want to make sure that we're, because it's about a half acre reduction in open space. So I just understanding a little bit more about that.
That's a good question. So in the 2018 City Center Park Plan update, it identified the opportunity for a 2.2 acre park to be located on this site to serve the City Center West, which is a zone larger than just this site. Mm-hmm. And as we've continued to work with this development agreement, the proposal includes not a single park location, but two park locations, mm-hmm. and that can be added onto as the rest of City Center West develops.
Gotcha.
And so that acreage that you cited includes park as well as public space, and the public space would just be the Festival Street.
Okay, thank you. That's important to understand. So this development isn't the entirety of the City Center West, so this is essentially their fair portion of the 2.2 acres.
This would be a portion of okay. the 2.2 acres.
Okay, excellent. Thank you.
Councilmember Hurst?
Great, thank you. What was the section on terms?
Section 18.
So is that still up for negotiation, or is this what we're stuck with?
We are not stuck with anything because the council has not approved anything in public hearing, but we are still working through clarification and trying to make sure that this section provides the most amount of certainty and guarantees for the developer to be able to maximize the property while at the same time making sure that we're best serving the city center.
So we're somewhere in, I think one of the summaries, they talked about how the typical development agreement runs maybe 10 years in this area, and we're offering 25 years possibly, and maybe more. But we're talking, this development should be the anchor for our city center, and we possibly are looking 15 years, maybe 25 years. And at the same time, we are going to vest them as far as some of the our codes and zones, correct? For the term of that term?
Yes.
It's problematic, I would think. But that seems like a long time. That's a quarter of a century, possibly. I would like to see this built in my lifetime. Anyway, that's problematic, I think. Now this is, again, I think I brought up a question and I didn't see a response, so I'll just bring it up again. So this is a transportation-oriented development, which is really, a lot of people like to say, is, and I think we've even had some discussions, that it's a good place for some affordable housing. And I don't see any within this plan, correct?
So currently the development agreement is no commitment to affordable housing. However, there's also no commitment to not allow affordable housing. So there's still an opportunity for future partnerships within the site. And some additional questions on the affordable housing. I'd like to defer to the applicant during the public hearing for them to answer those. Sure. So that they can explain what their target population is. We do recognize that all housing is important within Lynnwood, and this does propose a certain amount of housing. So we'd like them to further clarify what their market is for housing.
Okay. And then I guess I would share a concern as far as the green space. We were going to have a Village Green of 2.2 acres. If I remember right, the largest green space we're going to have is actually lawn is 10,000 square feet, so it's like the size of a large single-family residence lot. So we're going from 2.2 acres to pretty small area as far as green. I'm not quite sure if a festival street, I would consider that as a park. Again, just a concern that I have. I'm sure we could discuss this with the developer.
And Councilmember Hurst, I'd like to clarify, staff does agree with you, a festival street is not a park, and so we've titled it as a public space because it does have the opportunity to be closed for potential future markets and things, but we do recognize that that is not a park, and we've been try to make sure that that distinction has been made.
Okay, but they still want to use that as a credit, right, towards that
Park impact fee. The festival street would not qualify for a park impact fee credit.
Okay, just, and then one last one before I think of more. The private, so the interior streets are going to be private, so are they going to be built to the city standards for an arterial? Do they get to be narrower?
It's a great question. They're actually proposing that the lane widths be 13 feet in width, and these would not be arterials, but be local streets for the site themselves. And one of the reasons that they're proposing 13 feet in width, as well as a amended radius is for the turns, is to make sure that truck traffic serving the retail component and serving the grocery store can be able to access the site without damaging the radiuses. If you've driven around Seattle, you may have seen it, newer developments go in with slightly narrower driveways, and you quickly find that the turning radiuses don't always work, and you end up breaking the curbs down. And so the applicant's been very clear with us. Their goal is to build it to be able to get tenants in place, and that's their target market within those standards. David has anything else to add.
Yeah, those are all identified in the development agreement, the lane widths, the turn radii. So they will feel somewhat like a public street. Mm-hmm. Some of the streets, the 45th Street, I don't have a pointer here. Carl, if you can point to it for us, please.
This is actually a section of the 45th here with angled parking on one side and then parallel parking on the other side.
Be more of an active street with on-street retail, angled parking, where the other streets, 46 would be not quite so much, is my understanding. 44th. We're looking at primarily frontage improvements along there with the wide multi-use trail and some street trees and some landscaping buffer. So they'll have different feels to them. I don't know if that answered your question, though.
It does, but now that you're here, how are we going to discourage people from using it as through streets from 196 to 200?
Are you talking about either 45th or 46th?
Whichever.
The north-south?
46th, yeah. Yeah.
So the intersections up at 196th Street, there will be right-in, right-outs. That was the intent, to minimize the amount of through traffic in them. So rather than signalizing them at 196 and increasing the amount of cut-through traffic, is actually have them be right-in, right-out. So that would help cut down a lot of the cut-through traffic. And as Carl mentioned earlier, too, coming from the south, the Texas TE, or the transit center there, is intended primarily for transit, or just those that are dropping off at the Kiss and Ride. So we anticipate less cut-through traffic through there as well.
All right, thank you.
Councilmember Sessions.
Thank you for this presentation, and Councilmember Cotton asked two of my questions, and so those were good answers about the park size and the shared use path on 44th. That was a little unclear to me, but I think I understand that now, and the park size. Well, I'm glad you're not considering all that green space the same. I do still really like that festival space there, so that you can close off the street. And then Councilmember Hurst brought up a question that I thought I understood, but I don't now, is the timing of this. You don't really have a good answer for that, do you?
I don't. And so within the actual construction timing with the project, I would defer to the applicant during the time of public hearing.
And then if I can just clarify, because this is the part that I'm totally confused about. Director Klaitch?
I think, Mayor, members of council, I think during the public hearing those details will come out. It has been discussed that with the train 6 years out and then the absorption of the amount of space that's developed by the project, there is both practical reasons for that and financial risk reasons to gauge the period of time of build out to the realities of the market and the arrival of the train.
Okay, so I'm going to not worry too much about that then, right now. Okay. And then you mentioned the streets for retail deliveries and things, but we have to remember to fire ladder companies' engines to get through there.
Yep. So within the block phase planning, one of the asterisks that overrides the development is ensuring that throughout each phase of construction, whether the building's even under construction, is that services to EMS is provided, as well as general traffic circulation needs are met.
Thank you. Just the final thing about the timing is that I hope that at the public hearing that it can be pretty clear. I don't read between the lines very well, so you got to break it really down low to me. And I know nobody can guarantee anything, but I certainly hope that we don't have to worry about taking advantage of 25 years from now or even 10 years from now or whatever, that hopefully there's more clarity there. Thanks.
Councilmember Frizzell.
At this point, I'm echoing concerns about Section 18. I'd like to be able to nail down how many completed phases we're looking at by the time that light rail comes. I'm concerned about 20 years out still not being done with this project and still impacting even at 15 years out. I do know that we are somewhat past due for a recession correction, and I appreciate the caveats for that. But at the same time, light rail is coming. I don't see a big oops in their timeline for that, or not one that we've been made aware of. So I'm very concerned about the amount of time that this development agreement would go and the disruption of traffic as each phase gets brought online. I will echo Councilmember Hurst's concern about affordable housing and what we might be able to work into the agreement to help carry us a little further from our housing roundtable last week, to say that we want, we need, we desire affordable housing at all levels. And with this bringing in 1,300 plus new housing units, I'd like to see what we can do about having a percentage of that be workplace affordable, missing middle, however we want to term that. And another thing I'd like to see is a list of the mitigated issues. I read through and I see, oh, well, we're going to consider mitigating this or mitigating that. We're going to give credits here. It'd be nice to kind of see that all in one place so we know what we're giving and what we're getting. But thank you. Every time it becomes a little more clear, a little more excitable. I think that lot has sat empty for so long, and I'm excited to see it go forward.
Councilmember Hurst?
Two more, then I think I'm done for the night. It's mentioned a couple of times, so I'm just curious. The floor area ratio, we are committing to a floor area ratio of 3.95. Is this a deviation from what it should be?
No. So within the city center, there's a certain number of bonuses that happen. You're supposed to develop with these type of uses within this box. But if you do this, you get more FAR. And so what essentially the development agreement it goes into is it captures what that that bulk of the building on the site, so it's a land to building bulk ratio, would be locked in at 3.95. And that would be allowed by code, but it's essentially locking in how those bonus features would work across the entire site.
Okay. And then this may be a question beyond anybody's scope, but if we do the development agreement, I wonder, does it lock in the benefits of the Opportunity Zone financing? Anybody know?
That is a separate federal program, and so the local would not have authority to over-regulate that. The only thing that we'd be looking at is if the city had adopted anything regarding the Opportunity Zone, which we don't, but we do with the multifamily tax exemption.
That's right.
A great comparison. The MFTE is enabled by the state. We adopt that into our code, so that gets incorporated in the development agreement. The Opportunity Zone exists outside of our city authority.
But they didn't use the MFTE.
They are proposing that they can use it and it would be allowed for them to use it in the future, but it doesn't commit them to have to use it.
Got it. Okay. Thank you.
Anything else, Council? Anything in closing, Carl?
I appreciate your time, and if you have any questions, please feel free to email me. We'll include those in for the public record and bring those forward. And please remember, this is a quasi-judicial item. We are going to be moving forward to a public hearing. That date, we're working towards August. If it needs to adjust, it will. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you very much. Thank you, David. Thank you, guests. I do not have comments. Council Vice President, do you have council comments? Other council comments? Motion to adjourn then.
So moved.
Second.
And all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.